I received a pleasant surprise as dinner concluded. My wife surprised us at Andy's, but I think it was just because she thought she was going to get food. But we were already done eating, so the joke's on her, I guess. No, I'm thankful she's here. It was truly wonderful to see her. I didn't expect to see her. So I know you want to know what the chairs are all about. Maybe you're here and you do, but we will get to those in a little while. Tonight, I want to ask you to go ahead and open your Bibles to the book of Matthew, chapter 8. Matthew, chapter 8. And we're going to begin at verse 5 in just a moment. Matthew, chapter 8, beginning at verse 5. So far this week, we've been talking about this theme, Away We Go. And it's been looking at different places that we're traveling, different Bible lands that we're traveling, to look at what makes this place special. What happened here that I can learn from, that I need to know about, that will help me grow in my faith. And all week we've talked about different people who had this tremendous faith in God. We talked about Abraham the first night and his traveling from Ur all the way to the land of Canaan. We talked the second night about Ruth and being committed to Naomi wherever she was going to go. She made that powerful statement in verses 16 and 17 of Ruth chapter 1. Last night we talked about Samuel. We talked about God's call, and then we talked about our response to the call of God. And we talked about different ways that we could respond. Samuel responded with, "Speak, Lord, for your servant hears." Isaiah responded with, "Here am I, send me." And we looked at Moses, who was a great man of God, but when he was first called, he struggled. He struggled with accepting the call. And he made excuses as to why he wasn't good enough and as to why God should use somebody else. And tonight we're coming upon this man. A man, we don't know his name, but we know that he was a centurion. And we know that he shows tremendous faith. So tonight I'm going to ask you once again to get on this tour bus with me as we go to our next Bible land, the land of Capernaum. Verse 5 of chapter 8 of Matthew. Now when Jesus had entered Capernaum, a centurion came to him pleading with him, saying, "Lord, my servant is lying at home paralyzed, dreadfully tormented." And Jesus said to him, "I will come and heal him." The centurion answered and said, "Lord, I am not worthy that you should come under my roof, but only speak a word and my servant will be healed. For I also am a man under authority, having soldiers under me, and I say to this one, go, and he goes, and to another, come, and he comes, and to my servant, do this, and he does it." When Jesus heard it, he marveled and said to those who followed, "Assuredly, I say to you, I have not found such great faith, not even in Israel. And I say to you that many will come from east and west and sit down with Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob in the kingdom of heaven, but the sons of the kingdom will be cast out into outer darkness. There will be weeping and gnashing of teeth." Then Jesus said to the centurion, "Go your way, and as you have believed, so let it be done for you." And his servant was healed that same hour. Now there's a parallel account of this story, and that is found in Luke, the 7th chapter, verses 1 through 10. You'll find a little bit different information here, but it's not contradictory information. Okay, that's what we need to understand. There could be a phrase where when someone authorizes something, even though he's telling other people to do it, he's the person doing it because he's giving them the command to do what he needs them to do. And when you look at Luke 7, you see that the centurion sends men out to find Jesus and to tell him that there's someone that needs his help. And so as Jesus is coming to the centurion's house, the centurion comes out, and that's when he begins to have this conversation, this dialogue with Jesus. But it's very interesting when you start to look at this. One of the first things that I notice is it says, when it talks about the authority in verse 9, "For I also am a man under authority." A centurion, you could kind of compare it to a captain in our military, and a centurion was the head over 100 men. And they were respected, they were good men, honorable men, And you can tell from this that he also was an honorable man, and he had some faith in the Lord. Obviously, he had great faith, as Jesus makes a claim here in just a moment. But one of the first things the centurion says is, I understand what it feels like to have authority and to have power. I know how that works. And I know that when I tell somebody to do something, it happens. I know the authority and the power that you have. And if you simply say the words, my servant will be healed. And when you look at the translation of the word servant in the Greek, and I'm no Greek scholar by any means, but when you look at the translation in Luke, the word there is the same word for slave. So the centurion is coming to Jesus to ask him to heal his slave. That's pretty powerful. That tells me he's probably a pretty good man. But he says, I understand authority, and I know that you can do this thing. If you just speak it, it's going to happen. And then another thing that I catch from this story, verse 10, after he makes these claims, when Jesus heard it, he marveled. Now, there are two times where it talks about Jesus marveling. This one right here, and the other time when his own people reject him and won't accept him. It says that he marvels at their unbelief. But here we see that Jesus marveled at the great faith. And then he turns around and says to those around him, I have not seen this great of faith, not even in the house of Israel. And so you see this great claim that the Son of God is making on behalf of the centurion. This man has tremendous faith. He knows that I have the power to do anything that he needs me to do. And there was a law then where I believe it was that the Jews were not to enter the house of a Gentile. And so the centurion, thinking through this, I'm sure, went to Jesus and said, there's no need for you to come to my house. And he was probably thinking, if you come to my house, you're going to upset people. You're going to upset the Jews because they're going to try and pull this out and say this and that and the other and try and catch you in some kind of trap. He said, there's no need for that. I know that you can do it from right here. It's tremendous because we never hear about the faith of the one that needs to be healed. And a lot of times when Jesus heals people, there's not a long description of their great faith. A lot of times, some of them might not have even believed in Jesus. You can go back to the book of Mark when the men lower the paralytic through the roof of a house. And we don't know what the paralytic's faith was, but we know that Jesus heals them. But the first thing that he does in that story is he says, your sins are forgiven you. And then everybody's like, what? We brought him here for you to heal him. But Jesus looked at this man and saw that more than physical health, he needed spiritual health. And that's kind of a reminder back to talking about God's providing for us and how he will take care of our needs. He saw that this man needed spiritual forgiveness. And so he told him, your sins are forgiven you. And then to still prove to everyone around him that he did have the authority to forgive sins, he says in Mark, the second chapter, rise, take up your bed, and walk. So he still heals him physically. But we notice throughout Scripture, it wasn't always necessary for the person that Jesus healed to have strong faith. But here we see the instance of the centurion's faith. The tremendous faith to say, you speak it, it's going to happen. When we look at that, and I wonder, what would it be like if Jesus were to describe to somebody my kind of faith? Would he look at those around and say, I've not seen this great of faith, not even in the house of Israel? Would he look around and would the Scripture say, if this was me, Jesus marveled at this man's faith or this woman's faith? It's a tremendous example for us when it comes to faith. And so tonight, we look at this man that was a good and honorable man, this man that trusted in God and was committed to God and said to Jesus, if you speak, it'll happen. A man that had tremendous faith. What does the Bible say? If you have the faith as a mustard seed, you can move mountains. This man's faith was strong and powerful, and it's because of his faith that Jesus heals the man that needed to be healed. He heals this man's slave or his servant. So tonight, all week, we've been talking about the word commitment. We've been talking about committing to God, committing to the church, committing to the lost, committing our spiritual lives to living a life that pleases God and that will lead others to Him. We've talked about different examples of people doing that. Tonight, we're going to focus on this word, faith. And I want to ask the question as we go,
What about our faith? What about our faith that we have right now as Christians? The faith that you sitting in this pew possess. What kind of faith is that? That's the question I want us to think about. And remember, through everything that we do tonight, when we read the scriptures and try and dissect what they're saying, when we talk about these chairs in just a little while, and we talk about what they represent to us and try to learn from that, as we do all of this, you are the only person that can answer this question on the screen. You're the only person that knows the true depth of your faith to God. Because it doesn't matter how many service events you come to or how many times you come when the doors are open if your heart's not in the right place. And I don't know where your heart is, but you do. And so as we talk about our faith, do some serious reflection for yourself, because you're the only person other than God that knows where your faith is at this point in time. And the beautiful thing is, if we're allowed to get through tonight before the Lord returns, we don't know when He'll return. If we make it through tonight, then you have the chance to leave. If you're unsatisfied with what you find out in our study, you have the chance to walk out the door satisfied, knowing that you have the type of faith that would cause Jesus to say a phrase, or the Bible to say a phrase, that Jesus is marveling at the kind of faith you are displaying. To cause Jesus to look to others and say, why isn't your faith like this? And that's not arrogance on our part. Jesus wants us to have that kind of faith. And you can. But the only way that you can do that is if you look into your own heart and into your own mind and you evaluate for yourself, where is my faith? I can't tell you that. Freddie can't tell you that. The elders here cannot tell you that. Your wife or your children or whoever cannot tell you that. Your parents cannot tell you that. Only you can answer that. What about your faith? Turn in your Bibles to James, the second chapter.
Aha, there we go.
James chapter 2. Let's look at this explanation of faith. We referenced this a little bit the other night when we brought up some descriptions of faith. Tonight I want us to read it together. Man, I love the book of James. At the same time, I really dislike the book of James. Because he steps on your toes and he doesn't care. But he does it because of his love for the Lord and his love for the church and his love for the lost. Sometimes we need our toes stepped on. And the book of James doesn't hold back when it tells us how to live a faithful life for God. Look at chapter 2, verse 14. Why does it profit, my brethren, if someone says he has faith but does not have works? Can faith save him? If a brother or a sister is naked and destitute of daily food, and one of you says to them, depart in peace, be warmed and filled, but you do not give them the things which are needed for the body, what does it profit? Thus also faith by itself, if it does not have works, is dead. But someone will say, you have faith and I have works. Show me your faith without your works, and I will show you my faith by my works. Verse 19, you believe that there is one God, you do well. Even the demons believe and tremble. But do you want to know, O foolish man, that faith without works is dead? Was not Abraham our father justified by works when he offered Isaac his son on the altar? Do you see that faith was working together with his works, and by works faith was made perfect? And the scripture was fulfilled, which says, Abraham believed God, and it was accounted to him for righteousness, and he was called the friend of God. You see then that a man is justified by works and not by faith only. Verse 25, likewise was not Rahab the harlot also justified by works, when she received the messengers and sent them out another way? For as the body without the spirit is dead, so faith without works is dead. I see two things in this passage. Number one, I see that faith alone is not enough. Did you realize in these 13 verses that we just read, the phrase faith without works is dead is mentioned three times? Three times in 13 verses. Why is something repeated? Because because it's important. It needs to be remembered. James is trying to tell, to say here, faith without works is dead. And he talks a little bit, by the way, remember, faith without works is dead. And as you keep going, he says it again. Why? Because we need to remember that our works, that's how we prove our faith. It's really easy to say that I believe Jesus is the Son of God, but guess what? Even the demons believe and they tremble at Jesus. But do they follow Jesus? Faith alone is not enough. That's the first thing that I see. Second thing that I see is that our faith is justified by our works. Turn your Bibles to Hebrews chapter 11. Hebrews chapter 11. Hebrews 11. I want to ask you to look at verse 4. By faith, Abel offered to God a more excellent sacrifice through which he obtained witness that he was righteous, God testifying of his gifts, and through it, he being dead, still speaks. So the first thing we see in verse 4 is the faith of Abel. Well, how do we know he was faithful? Because of the sacrifice that he offered. Action. What he did proved his faith. I want to ask you now to drop to verse 7. By faith, Noah, being divinely warned of things not yet seen, moved with godly fear, prepared an ark for the saving of his household, by which he condemned the world and became heir of the righteousness which is according to the faith. Or according to faith. How do we know of Noah's faith? Because he built an ark. Action. Look at verse 8. By faith, Abraham obeyed. How did he obey? When he was called to go out to the place which he would receive an inheritance, and he went out, not knowing where he was going. Verse 9. By faith, he dwelt in the land of promise as in a foreign country, dwelling in tents with Isaac and Jacob, the heirs with him of the same promise. For he waited for the city which has foundations, whose builder and maker is God. How do we know of Abraham's faith? Because he went and he dwelt. Action. Let's go a little further. Look at verse 11. By faith, Sarah herself also received strength to conceive seed, and she bore a child when she was past the age, because she judged him faithful who had promised. Therefore, from one man, and him as good as dead, were born as many as the stars of the sky in multitude, innumerable as the sand which is by the seashore. Her faith, she bore a son for the Lord. She bore a son for Abraham. She gave him Isaac. Drop down to verse 17. By faith, Abraham, when he was tested, offered up Isaac. Action. Genesis 22, we read of Abraham, after he's finally received that son, being told, I'm going to need you to offer a sacrifice. I'm going to need you to kill your son. And he goes to do it. He's ready to do it. Because he's faithful to the Lord. And the Lord provides. And he never has to actually hurt his son in any way. But he was going to. He went. He took him. He didn't take a sacrifice, hoping God would change his mind. He took Isaac, and he was ready. He made actions that pleased God. That's how we know of his faith. Verse 20. By faith, Isaac blessed Jacob and Esau concerning things to come. Action. By faith, Jacob, when he was dying, blessed each of his sons and worshiped, leaning on the top of his staff. Verse 22. By faith, Joseph, when he was dying, made mention of the departure of the children of Israel and gave instructions concerning his bones. When you look at verse 23. By faith, Moses, when he was born, was hidden 3 months by his parents because they saw he was a beautiful child and they were not afraid of the king's command. Verse 24. By faith, Moses, when he became of age, refused to be called the son of Pharaoh's daughter, choosing action, rather to suffer affliction with the people of God than to enjoy the passing pleasures of sin. Brothers and sisters, when we look at Hebrews 11 and we talk about the hall of fame of the faithful, there's not a person mentioned where we don't see their actions proving their faith.
It's not just mentioned that this person has great faith, but it is explained why they had great faith. Our faith can be great, but only when our actions are proving our faith. A friend of mine once said, "People may doubt what you say, but they'll believe what you do." What is the other phrase? "People don't care how much you know till they know how much you care." People are watching you every day, and they're taking your actions and they're using them to justify whether or not you really are a child of God, or if you're another hypocrite walking the streets of Dunlap, Tennessee. And again, that's how you live. That's your call on what you're doing. That's your judgment right now, taking these things that we've talked about and looking at your own self and seeing if you're walking a life where people can look and say, "There's a child of God." Or are you walking a life where people can't really tell you apart from the person at Walmart? We've got to be separate, set apart, and different. We prove our faith through action. Are your actions proving that faith? There's a challenge for you to begin with. So now we come to the second question, or a question here. We asked the question, what about our faith? And we're continuing that thought. The first thought was, are our actions proving our faith? Now let's talk about these chairs. Don't worry, I'm not going to call anybody up here to sit down in them. I also know that I said action a lot when we were reading Hebrews 11, and I'm sure there was somebody in here in their mind that was saying live action. If you ever watched Turtle Man, Sawyer and Wyatt would have got that. When we look at this question of which chair are we in, there are four chairs up here. Each one represents, and I'll tell you this, every person in this auditorium tonight is in one of these four chairs. But it goes back to self-evaluation, because I can't tell you which chair you're in. Neither can anybody else in this room. Only you can do that. And so as we talk about these, I want you to think which chair you're in. And it's probably going to happen that as I describe them, you're like, "Yep, that's my chair right there." So pay attention and challenge yourself and answer truthfully. But every person here tonight is in one of these four chairs. So let's talk about them a little bit. Chair number one. This chair represents the atheist or the non-believer. Now, there may be some of you here tonight that wandered in because you saw there was a VBS and you wanted to see what was going on here at the Dunlap Church of Christ. You saw that name Cody Boston and you wanted to see what was he going to talk about. How many times was he going to mess up? How unfunny are his jokes? My wife always tells me, most of the time after classes or whatever else, we'll be in the car on the way home, and she's so encouraging. She'll look at me and she'll say, "Yeah, that really wasn't funny." So, you know, the last few nights you guys have laughed at my jokes and I felt good, and then she showed up tonight and I got a little scared. Maybe you're here tonight and you consider yourself a non-believer or an atheist. You just, this whole religion thing isn't for you. It never has been. And to that response, I go to the book of Genesis, chapter 1. And I read time and time again the phrase, "Then God said." And then I see time and time again, after he said something, it happened. And then I can walk out these doors and I can see the light. I can see the sun. I can see the moon and the stars and the clouds. I can see the trees and the animals and the plants. I can see other people walking to cars. I can see the babies sitting in the front row and how they are moving their arms and they are smiling and laughing. And I look at all of these things and I say, there is a God. There is a God. It takes more faith for someone to say they don't believe in God than it does for someone to say they do. There's so much evidence. So much evidence. But maybe you're here tonight. Maybe this is where you are. Just, you don't believe. If that's the case, I strongly encourage you to sit down with Brother Freddie or with elders. Sit down with someone and ask those questions that are on your heart that you want to try to find answers for. And then be ready for how the Word of God responds to those answers. Because Freddie's not going to tell you his opinion. Freddie's going to point you to the Scriptures. I know that because I've been blessed to know Freddie my whole life. And I'd say the same thing for all the elders here and a lot of the men here that I've known my whole life. They're going to point you to Scriptures for answers. Maybe you're here tonight, though. We'll move on. Maybe you're not here. You find yourself in chair number two, which looks a lot like chair number one. But there's a little bit of faith there. This chair is full of good people. Good people, they believe there's a God. They come when it's Easter. They come when it's Christmas. They come on Father's Day or Mother's Day. They come every once in a while because there's nothing else to do or the weather's not too good to go out on the lake. They're here. But yeah, there's a God, and they try to help people. They try to give to the poor when they can. I mean, they're pretty active in the community. They're known as good people. But they've got this thing going on called partial obedience. They know there's a God. They've heard about Him. Romans 10:17, faith comes by hearing, hearing by the Word of God. They believe that statement. They believe there is a God. They probably might have even repented of their past sins. They're trying to live a right kind of life. And they'll tell people about their faith. Oh yeah, I'm religious. I'm religious. I believe in Jesus. But they're not willing to fully commit. They just can't fully commit. They can't take the step to get into the water. There's just no need for it. They can't fully give up that hobby. They can't be here every single Sunday because there's ball games and there's nice days where I need to be out doing things in the yard. And I work every other day of the week, and Sunday's my day to kind of relax and lay back and not worry about anything else, and I just can't give that up. And go on and on with the list. But for some reason, they cannot fully commit to God. And maybe this is where you find yourself tonight. You've never obeyed the gospel. You've never put on Christ in baptism. As the Bible tells us in Galatians 3 and Acts chapter 2, the book of Romans, on and on, all these scriptures that talk about baptism. You just can't, take that last step. And you're okay with that for now. Everything's okay. Life's okay. We talked about how all spiritual blessings, Ephesians 1:3 tells me all spiritual blessings in heavenly places are found in Christ. We talked about hope and how that's found in Christ. Without the blood of Jesus, your sins are not taken away. And as long as your sins are connected to you, there is no way for you to appear before God righteous. It's simply impossible. God cannot have that before Him. And as long as those sins remain in contact, you cannot enter into heaven. And those are not my words. Those are the words of God. And so baptism is absolutely essential because that's where you come into contact with the only thing that can take away your sins. And that's the blood of Jesus. And so you've got to be buried and die to your old self and come up a new creature ready to live a different life, a life that's no longer about self, but a life that's about others, a life that's about serving the one true God and serving Jesus Christ and committing yourself to God, committing yourself to the church, and committing yourself to those who are lost. But you're here. For whatever reason, you can't take that last step. That final step to put you into Christ. We're going to save that one for last. Let's talk about this chair. Chair number four. This is the faithful child of God. This is the one who has been baptized into the blood of Christ and raised to be a new creature, living a different life. Living a life dedicated and committed to God Almighty and doing everything they can to serve Him. They are active in the church. Notice I said the word active. Sometimes a lot of churches are just as good as if there were a bunch of mannequins in the pews. I think that was Ron Gilbert that told me that. I don't remember if it was, but it sounds like something he would say. But it's so truthful because of complacency. Complacency sets in and we're okay with being where we are spiritually. Brothers and sisters, let me tell you this. You will never stay in the same place spiritually. And what I mean by that is if you are not striving to grow, then you are digressing in your spiritual walk. I fully believe that. If you're not striving to grow in faith, then your faith is declining. You are never staying in the same place. This chair here is the person that's fully committed. They take up their cross every day and follow in the footsteps of Jesus, Luke 9, verse 23. They are giving everything that they have to God and to the church and to the lost because they know what it feels like to be lost. And they want to make sure nobody has to feel like that ever again. They have found the cure to the worst disease in the entire world, and they're not going to be stingy with it. This is the chair that all of you tonight are looking at and saying, man, I hope I'm in that chair. But I don't want you to answer with the chair you hope you're in. I want you to answer with the chair you're in. This is the chair we strive for as Christians. This is the chair we must be in as Christians. We've looked at Abraham. He was in this chair. We talked about Ruth. She was in the chair. Last night, talking about Samuel, he was in this chair. David, while he made mistakes with his heart, he was a man after God's own heart, he was in this chair. We as Christians need to be in this chair. But I feel that the majority of us here this evening, and not just here, but in the church in general, find ourselves in chair number 3. I believe the Bible calls it the lukewarm chair. Now let me tell you something. This chair looks pretty comfortable. It's got cushions a little bit. You can sit back, take it easy. Feels nice. You can catch the game. Drink a sun drop. It's a good chair. Why would you want to leave this chair? It's comfortable. It's nice. This is the person who used to be in this chair. But life and distractions got in the way and moved them from this chair to this chair. They're just okay. If you notice, there's a little bit different design to this one and this one. This one looks a little rougher. Looks a little more difficult to sit in for a longer period of time. Christian life isn't always the easiest life to live, but it's the best life we could ever live. But a lot of us here tonight find ourselves in this chair, even though we don't want to say we're in this chair. We are. We're not willing to fully commit. And while we are not in chair number 2, while we have obeyed the gospel and we are Christians, we are part of the church, we're not fully committed. We're not all in. We're part of the way in. We're not doing our part to fulfill our duties within the body of Christ. Are you lukewarm? I'm not going to ask for a show of hands, but if you've ever taken a sip of lukewarm water, oh, it's nasty. It's awful. Jesus says that when we're lukewarm, he would spew us or spit us out of his mouth. That's how disgusted he is with partial commitment. All week we've talked, God expects full commitment in order to receive his full promises. In other words, when God tells me to do something and I'll receive this, I can't go to a certain point and expect to receive it if I don't all the way commit. When Lauren and I got married, I didn't have a list of things that I was okay with committing to and a list of things I didn't really care about committing to. I had to be all in, or the marriage is not going to work. If you're not all in for God, the relationship is not going to work. Your faith is not going to grow. You will not find yourself in this chair because there's something that's keeping you in this chair or in the other chair if you've never obeyed the gospel. But something's holding you back. And that something is you're not willing to give your entire self over to Jesus. What chair are you in tonight? Here's the reality. Here's the beautiful thing. No matter which chair you're in, if you want to be in a different one, get up and move. I'm not going to pick you up and set you down.
can't. It wouldn't do any good. You'll just move back to the chair you were in. If you want to be in a different chair, if you're not happy with where you are, the only person that can do something about it is you. You've got to take action and stand up and move to where you want to be. If you're here and you're tired of being here, get up and move to where you need to be. What was it we were just talking about? Faith has proved how? Action. You prove your faith by getting up and moving. Sometimes in life, I don't know what it is, but we find ourselves playing this game of spiritual musical chairs. And one day we're over here and life is good and everything's great. And the next day we find ourselves here. And we're just sitting here and we're life is good. Nothing bad's going on right now. I guess everything's okay. Well, I know I haven't been to church in a while, but that's okay. Well, I know that they were doing something down at the building and I could have went, but it's been a long week. I think I'm going to stay home. Well, I know that I could have talked to more of my friends and just asked them to come to services with me. And then a little while later, everything's going good again. But then we're back here. It's like back and forth with these two chairs. I don't know what it is, but we're playing spiritual musical chairs. But guess what? One day the music's going to stop, and we're going to be found in one of the two chairs. And if we're not in the chair we're supposed to be in, there is no round two. There is no more second go, one more chance, let's play the music one more time. That's it. If you're not happy with where you are, get up, and I beg you to move. Move to where you need to be. If you've never obeyed the gospel, stand up, go into the blood of Jesus, and let it wash away your sins, and begin living the best life you can ever live, a life that tells people or causes people to look at you and to say, man, look at that faith in God. At a time when our country is going so far away from Him, this person looks like they can't be any closer to Him. Wow. Guys, we read about people in the Bible that have that kind of faith, and we think that it's something far-fetched that we could ever have something like that. That's not the case at all. The Bible was written, what? The Old Testament stories are written for our learning, right? That we, through patience and comfort of the Scriptures, might have hope. We can have that kind of faith. The Hall of Fame of the Faithful can be decorated with your name, too. But your actions have got to get you there. Now, I'm not saying that my actions bring me salvation. It's the blood of Jesus that does that. But what I'm saying is, I have a responsibility to continue to prove my faith every day through my actions. And the way that I choose to live my life on this earth will determine where I go for eternity. I have a short time to make an impact. And I will impact the lives of people. How am I going to do that? That's the question you have to answer. As we look lastly about our faith, and as we think about being in the last chair and striving, you say, Cody, I really want to be in that chair, and I know that I'm not. What do I need to do? I want to offer a list of things for us as Christians to start doing that can help us be in that chair and stay in that chair. And I tried to make it easy, since we're focusing on the word action a little bit with our faith tonight. I took the word serve, and I took each letter of the word serve and made another point, so easier to remember, hopefully. So let's go through that together. What can you do to stay in chair number four? Make sure you're in the right chair. Number one, surrender. What do you mean, Cody? I mean fully commit to God. It's time to quit with this partial obedience. It's time to quit with being halfway in and halfway out. It's time to jump all the way in, to get ready and to go. Galatians 2 verse 20, a song we sing all the time. Paul says, I am crucified with Christ, nevertheless I live, yet not I but Christ lives in me. Now the life that which I now live in the flesh, I live by faith and the Son of God who loved me and gave himself for me. Paul's basically saying here, I've died to my old self. I've crucified the old self. And every day that I live now is a day that I'm living for Christ. I'm all in. I've bought in. I'm ready. Surrender yourself to God. Take up your cross every day and follow him. Luke 9 verse 23. if you give yourself over to God and you dedicate yourself to serving Him, you surrender your time and your effort to God's will, what He tells us to do in His Word, you'll find yourself in that chair. You'll find yourself living a life that brings happiness to God, that pleases God. Secondly, endless prayer. What do I mean by that? 1 Thessalonians 5:17 says, pray without ceasing. So my challenge for you is to go home tonight and to pray, and don't stop praying ever. I'm just kidding. Pray without ceasing is this mentality that you can pray about anything at any time. There's never something that's, if it's from your heart, God wants you to pray about it. Some people get this idea, well, God already knows it. He wants you to tell Him. He wants you to tell Him. And you will not find yourself in this chair if you do not pray every day to your Father in heaven. Because let me tell you something, you need that prayer. You need it. You need that time to talk to God. So secondly, endless prayer. Number three is the word remember. What do you mean remember? Number one, remember the cross. Remember the cross. Remember that you have hope because of the cross. Because Jesus raised from the dead and ascended to heaven, you have hope. And you don't have to live the same life anymore because Jesus died for you. Don't ever forget that. But secondly, remember your mission. We talked about God's call and how are we going to respond to the call of God. Remember, there's a world full of people who are lost. There's a town full of people who are lost. What are we going to do to change that? Remember the lost. Remember your mission to reach the lost. And finally, with the word remember, remember that if you do those two things, remember the cross, remember your mission, and live every day seeking God first and seeking the kingdom first, remember that He will provide and take care of you. Trust in that. We're almost done. Number four, letter V, volunteer. What do you mean by that? I mean, when you see things that need to be done, don't wait to be asked. Just get up and do them. We've gotten, and working with teenagers, I try to focus on this a lot, because we've gotten to a place in our country where a lot of people are willing to help, but they want to be asked. Brothers and sisters, we got to stop that nonsense, and we just got to help. There are people that need help. Help them. The church needs help. Help the church. There are things you can do. Do it. But volunteer to do it. Be ready to serve always. Prove your faith through your actions by volunteering your time and your efforts. And finally, is the word everyone. What do I mean by that? I mean this. Remember that Jesus died for everyone. And remember that everyone needs to hear the gospel message. And remember that there are people that are included within that everyone that you're the only person that will be able to influence their lives. So do that. Our time is up. If you're writing it down, remember that surrender, endless prayer, remember, volunteer, and everyone. I hope that was kind of clear and easy to remember and understand. Thank you for your time this evening, and look forward to sharing in the invitation here in just a moment.